Your whole life is just a dream.
I am immortal.
I think you have been afraid all your life.
Now, open your mind to me.
It's a dream.
You have always been here.
It's a dream.
Happy heresies, true seekers, free thinkers, mystics, and magicians, and all the rest of you clandestine agents of the continuous divine invasion. Welcome to the Alpha and Omega radio show, dealing with the elusive and enigmatic topic of Gnosticism. This is Aeon Byte, or formerly known as Coffee, Cigarettes, and Gnosis. This has, is, and always will be the approachable, comprehensive, and affable discussion about the world's favorite and least known heretics, the Gnostics, and their brethren in the esoterica.
I'm so afraid of how powerful this is!
I am so grateful you have emanated yourselves at the virtual Alexandria on this approximately Saturday, September 20th, the year of our Demiurge 2008. My name is Miguel Connor, otherwise known as your host, Abraxas, the personification of the Pleroma, the fullness of the divine, yet instant madness to those who might behold the solar logos.
Anyone who isn't dead or from another plane of existence would do well to cover their ears right about now.
I hope you're ready to continue this journey of knowledge and sparkling drama here at Aeon Byte, broadcast through the godabovegod.com. I hope you're as comfortable with your insanity as I am. I hope you've got fuel in your cup and some cancer sticks to set a fire. After all, we are the Gnostics, the eternal cafe culture of all times and places. From the streets of ancient Alexandria, where our spiritual ancestors radicalized all things holy and philosophical, to the scenic, haunting landscapes of Languedoc, where the Cathars exchanged the wisdom of the ages with Kabbalists, troubadours, women rulers, Knights Templar, and even Catholic clergy.
You know, this is, excuse me, a damn fine cup of coffee.
Or from the dirty streets of Rome of old, haranguing the Orthodox Christians on the nature of Jesus, to the cyber dominions of today, where we politely spread the truth about the Christianity before Christianity. That is us, curious and introverted, but never shy to swap esoteric recipes with other tourists of the universe over some Java, wine, or spirit. And like in the past, there are those who want to silence and suppress us. But we are mystic guerrillas always arising throughout history, because the Gnostic essence cannot be censored for too long, since its source is not linear, but comes from the higher, vertical information of the aeons and luminaries.
People should not be afraid of their governments. Governments should be afraid of their people.
And here at the virtual Alexandria, where the souls of the great Gnostic saints keep us company like muses, we continue to relate their great annals and teachings that exploded in the dark iron prison and its holographic universe.
There must be some kind of way out of here.
Today, or more like in this eternal now, we present to you perhaps one of the most important of these Gnostic saints. Most of you know him well enough, maybe from some barely remembered high school course or watching the movie Red Dragon. Perhaps you have been seduced and inspired by his high-octane yet subtle poetry and art, but few understand that this wordsmith was a torchbearer for the classic Gnostics and the ongoing rescue operation of Pista Sophia and the Cosmic Christ. And this is none other than William Blake.
We don't read and write poetry because it's cute. We read and write poetry because we are members of the human race, and the human race is filled with passion.
To leave no doubt lingering in your mind, always being infected by your tyrannical ego and its pandemic illusions, we have with us today Eric G. Wilson, author of Secret Cinema, Gnostic Vision and Film, the spiritual history of ice, romanticism, science, and imagination, and the brand new Against Happiness in Praise of Melancholy, among several other books and very sexy articles that he's written. Eric is also professor of English at Wake Forest University and is beatifying us with his second appearance at Aeon Byte. If you get a chance or 20, please download Aeon Byte number 50, where we discuss Gnostic cinema, and you'll see Eric as an individual with the hand on the pulse of Gnosticism in all its historic and artistic avatars.
To protect the sheep, you gotta catch the wolf. And it takes a wolf to catch a wolf, you understand?
William Blake indeed is a true Gnostic visionary and prophet that I've quoted many times on past programs. The term prophet being a tongue-in-cheek rebuttal to the fundagelicals and their cottage industry of creating prophets like David Koresh, Oral Roberts, Fred Phelps, and Benny Hinn, just to name a few while I hold my nose. And many of you lovers of the esoterica have unfortunately had to stomach modern counterfeit Gnostic prophets like Sylvia Brown, Samuel Ann Weir, the owner of Ebionite.com, and a locust crowd of smaller ones that have sprouted like crotch spiders in the last few decades.
Please allow me to introduce myself. I'm the devil!
You see, a true Gnostic sage doesn't just sit around giving his take on the Gospel of Thomas or the Tree of Life of the Kabbalah. A true Gnostic sage rarely admits he's Gnostic and never claims to have a monopoly on the Autobahn to the Pleroma.
You can't handle the truth!
Like Simon Magus, Mary Magdalene, Manny the Prophet, Carlos Castaneda, Philip K. Dick, C.G. Jung, and of course William Blake, he or she redefines the Gnostic message in the cultural context of his or her days. Like I keep saying, he or she writes his own gospel and lives his or her own myth. The Gnostic sage radically reinterprets what has already been radically reinterpreted. And that's what Blake did ever so skillfully and beautifully. Many of the vessels of the created love of Sophia don't even have to have much direct contact with the writings of the classic Gnostics. They just tapped into the great, uncharted waters of the collective unconscious and drew their inspiration from there.
Whatever door you open in my brain, I want you to shut it now!
And in his own interpretation of the Gnostic cosmology, Blake saw the universe as an imperfect construct, not as negative as the Sethians or Ophites, but nonetheless a place to transcend. He saw divine knowledge as a key to soul liberation, and faith as a placebo that was shoved down the throats in spiritually dead religious institutions. He understood the Demiurge, Sophia, and the cosmic struggle between ignorance and salvific knowledge. He devised his own mythological system loyal to his predecessors, and his art directly draws from ancient Gnostic motifs and timeless archetypes. Lastly, for you jihadist atheists, Blake railed against the slow-eating, unchallenged cancer of pure reason and logic.
You have been weighed. You have been measured, and you have been found wanting.
Eric will further clarify my drivel, delving into other romantic poets, and will also discuss his new book, Against Happiness, a short but poignant work with some very breathtaking prose.
It's all part of the plan.
What, you might ask? Against happiness? That goes against modern thought. Life, liberty, and the pursuit of happiness, wrote the great Freemason Thomas Jefferson, didn't he? Happiness is a side effect of spiritual and mental growth, right? Not necessarily. The Buddha said, be thankful for what you have, but know that it is temporal. Happiness, by definition and actuality, is always a temporal phenomenon. As true seekers, we seek the permanent and the ultimate reality. Happy days bring joy, but really don't bring growth or even opportunity. Happy days are just happy days, at least until the infamous Jump the Shark episode.
Well, have you considered the possibility that you're simply not meant to be happy, no matter where you are?
No, I haven't. Not until you mentioned it.
Melancholy and sadness are the true eyes into peering to the farther shores. It's just the way humans are constructed. This all goes against everything we've been taught in our materialistic, short attention, instant gratification society. But then again, unvarnished deliverance from the matrix goes against everything we've been taught by the celestial and earthly archons.
That's very materialistic.
Well, life is materialistic. I can't help it. I didn't invent it. I'm just in it.
So is being moody and morose the answer? Let's be Jim Morrison or Van Gogh or Amy Winehouse. Not exactly, although when we study great artists, mystics or historical figures, we do find them often living at the edges of sanity for long periods. No, what I'm talking and what Eric will talk about is what the ancient Gnostics and C.G. Jung and the Buddha advise. Something called wholeness, individuation, balance, the middle path, detachment, and so forth. And let me be clear, if you're searching for just happiness in Gnosticism, you'll be disappointed. Go look for another system or guru like Joel Osteen or Deepak Chopra. If you want to fit in the world, find cottony inner peace, or buttery solutions to life's problems, forget about Gnosticism.
It's a huge shit sandwich and we're all gonna have to take a bite.
Hang out in the self-help section of Borders, drink Lexapro milkshakes, play some Huey Lewis, and listen to your local pastor tell you that all God wants is for you to be happy for 70 or so years. Only heroes, fools, and madmen across the waters get to travel up the heavens ruled by the powers and authorities.
And if there is a hell, and those sons of bitches are from it, then there has got to be a heaven, Jacob. There's got to be.
We'll get to this in William Blake after I quote this passage from the Gospel of Philip that might grant you with a little bit more perspective on the pitfalls of just wanting to be happy. Light and darkness, life and death, right and left, are brothers of one another. They are inseparable. Because of this, neither are the good good, nor evil evil, nor is life life, nor death death. For this reason, each one will dissolve into its earliest origin. But those who are exalted above the world are indissoluble, eternal. Think about it or don't. Death spares none but the tiger. But now our interview with Eric Wilson, my beloved True Seekers. This is the Aeon Byte interview. With us today, we definitely have the pleasure of having for a second time Eric Wilson to discuss the Gnosis of William Blake, some of the Romantic poets and beyond, as well as his new book, Against Happiness in Praise of Melancholy. And we'll be sure to tie it all up. How are you doing today, Eric?
I'm doing fine, Miguel. Thanks for having me on the show again.
Oh, it's my pleasure. It's my pleasure. So why don't we start with, of course, the Gnostic sage himself, or the Gnostic saint to some. Could you give us a brief account on the life of William Blake?
Sure, I'll be glad to. As you probably know, Blake grew up in one of the most exciting times in the Western world. The time that showed us the French Revolution, the time that showed us the transition from the Age of Enlightenment to what we now know as the Romantic Age. Also the age of Emanuel Swedenborg, an age in which many Protestant sects like the Ranters and the Muggletonians were kind of peopling the theological landscape in England. It was kind of a fervor of visionary theology. So Blake grew up in London, lower middle class family, and at a very young age he had visions. As early as 10 years old he would go walking around the hayfields on the outskirts of London and often see angels spangling the trees. And at one point he came home and told his parents of this, and his father threatened him with a whipping. A very early instance of the tyranny, we might say, of the father figure and a desire to aspire to a vision beyond that. This visionary quality in Blake persisted throughout his life. He often saw angels, often conversed with them, saw them with the same kind of clarity with which we might see a mockingbird or a building. and this he shared with Swedenborg, very kind of a concrete visionary sensibility. He translated this at an early age into artistic training. In fact, he was apprenticed to an artist. He went to art school and became a printer, printed illustrations for books, and this was how he made his money throughout his life. And he, in his printing, generally had a rather visionary quality to them, like to paint biblical themes, like to paint angels. But then, of course, his printing started feeding into his poetry. He also started writing poetry at a fairly early age. He came out when he was very young with some of his more famous poems, Songs of Innocence and Experience, Marriage of Heaven and Hell. But eventually he went for bigger visionary game, writing such grand Gnostic prophecies like Milton, Jerusalem, the Four Zoas, each of which he illustrated with his fabulous, rich art. So that's just sort of a very brief biographical sketch of Blake. I'd be happy now to talk a little bit about his Gnostic tendencies, unless you would like me to take another direction or if you have a question for me.
Yeah, before that, two things. I know Blake was in it. Wasn't he in, which I find, I guess it's just he was a part of the day, but he was in a loveless, sexless marriage, wasn't it? Did that influence his melancholy at all?
Well, he feared madness at a fairly early age. Some of the poets that were contemporary with him, like Christopher Smart, John Cooper, flirted with madness, both spent times in lunatic asylums, in fact. And he himself always felt that his visionary capacities, while the muse of his art, may also be attached to mental illness. In fact, he said throughout his life he was beset by a nervous fear. And we can talk about that in a bit in relationship to his Gnosticism. So I think he probably was prone to what we now call mental illness. However, yes, he did marry young, a woman named Catherine, loved her very much, but found out very early on that she was unable to bear children. She was of a religious mind in such a way that she thought that copulation should only be used in service of having children. Since she couldn't have children, no sex. Blake, being a rather free thinker, suggested rather promptly that they bring a woman into their house that could become Blake's concubine. She did not go for that idea, unfortunately for Blake. So yes, it was a sexless marriage, but not a loveless marriage. They stayed together their whole lives and defended each other, loved each other, took care of each other. I think it was a pretty happy marriage on the whole. And one could get Freudian here and suggest that Blake certainly sublimated his libido into his works of art.
Right, right. And before we really get into the meat of Blake's Gnosticism, besides his visions, did he have any connections to any of the Gnostic writings from the heresiologists, or was he influenced or part of any esoteric organizations?
Well, early on, Blake moved around with a rather radical group of thinkers, among them William Godwin, among them Joseph Priestley, all of whom were proponents of a very early version of what we would now call comparative religion. So many of these thinkers were very much aware of some of the early Christian heresies, Gnosticism among them. In fact, Joseph Priestley wrote a book himself, a kind of history of Christianity and heresy. So he would have learned about Gnosticism from these thinkers, mainly Gnosticism filtered through the anti-heresy folks like Irenaeus. But also Blake would have been aware of Gibbon, who in his account of the rise and fall of Rome had a bit to say about the Gnostics. There's another book by a fellow named Nathaniel Lardner, A Long History of Heretics, long sections on Gnosticism there. And Pierre Bayle wrote this massive Enlightenment encyclopedia, and he had several interesting entries on the Gnostics. So the ideas were in the air, and Blake would have gotten them through reading as well as just through conversing. But I will say that Blake's most important influence in terms of Gnosticism was the 17th century Prussian cobbler Jakob Bjoma, the great theosophist who was trying really hard to bring the perennial philosophy into some kind of grand synthesis, bringing together alchemy, hermeticism, Gnosticism, Platonism, Egyptian metallurgy, all manner of occult ways of knowing show up in some of Bjoma's work. And aside from Swedenborg, I would say Bjoma was the most powerful influence on Blake.
And what are some of the Gnostic motifs found in his poetry?
The main one is that Blake had a real sense that the God of the Judeo-Christian tradition was not the true God, was indeed a third-rate demiurge at best, possibly an evil demiurge. We see this in a poem he wrote kind of in the middle of his life called To Noba Daddy, in which he likens the Judeo-Christian God to a nobody plus a granddaddy. this kind of impotent old figure who doesn't quite know what he's doing, a senile old man. In another poem, like The Tiger, he fashions the demiurge as an engineer, a rather sinister engineer who bends and cracks and breaks and fires these creatures into a kind of tortured being. But I would say, in general, the best way to get at Blake's Gnosticism is to get a little bit into his metaphysical system. It's a bit arcane, but I'm sure your listeners are used to arcane
texts, right.
Given their readings in the Gnostic myths. So I'll be brief, but I will say that Blake had this theory of both the human and of the cosmos. And for Blake, the human is a microcosm of the macrocosm. He thought that each human and the universe itself was made up of four components he called the four zoas, or four living creatures. And one of them was reason, or urizen. One of them was instinct, or erthona. Another was passion, or luva. And yet another was sensation, or tharmas. He made these words up himself. So there's a sense that I, in an unfallen state, the cosmos and the human alike are this wonderfully harmonious dance among four thriving beings, a kind of harmonious fourfold. We can probably liken this to the Gnostic Pleroma before it fell, this beautiful, exquisite, fully spiritual light and sound show, as it were. Well, what happens? For Blake, at a certain point, the figure for reason, urizen, wanted to rebel against the other three zoas and set himself up as the first and foremost and most powerful one of the zoas. And in doing so, he tried to establish reason as the only arbiter of truth, reason as the only method for making inquiries into the world. So the minute urizen did this, he threw all the four zoas into disarray, into chaos. He created time and space. He created reason, he created priests, he created politicians, he basically created this world. So for Blake, the creation of the world, the physical world of time and space, is the first fall. It's the massive catastrophe. And again, it comes out of reason trying to posit itself as the primary mode of being and throwing all the other various zoas out of whack. Now that happens cosmically with the beginning of the physical world, but also it happens in each of us. And this is where Blake kind of ties in with Jung in interesting ways. Each of us, ideally seen, is a kind of fourfold harmonious dance of these four components. But in our own beings, we often try to posit one zoa at the expense of the others, and therefore kind of throw ourselves into disarray and into a fallen state. This is the primary way that Blake has this Gnostic leaning. Yeah, that the physical world is based on a colossal error.
But Blake didn't have the negative connotation that the Gnostics did. Wasn't he a bit more positive about things?
That's correct. So for Blake, there's always hope. Blake tinctured his Gnosticism with a sort of Neoplatonism. Blake did believe ultimately that the world that we live in is fallen, but we were always yet a vision away from recovering our health, from moving back to Eden, as it were. And how do we do this? Through an act of the imagination. For Blake, the artist is the true prophet. For Blake, the artist is the true seer. For Blake, the artist is, we might say, the true Gnostic. The artist understands that the world, as it has been constructed by the priests, the politicians, is an illusory world. It's a world based on power relationships where the scientists, the philosophers, the priests, the politicians are trying to keep people oppressed, basically by imposing upon them systems, rational systems. So Blake thought that the artist could see this and could see through these systems and ultimately see beyond the material world to this kind of invisible realm called Eden, which is that fourfold and perfect harmony. And we're only a vision away from seeing this. And when we do intuit this, we immediately want to create works of art that somehow express this. Put rather briefly, Blake in Marriage of Heaven and Hell said, most people see the world as though they're seeing light through a chink in a cavern, but the true visionary cleanses the doors of perception and sees the world as it is, infinite. So for Blake, there is a kind of immanent spirit in the world. We just block ourselves from it by believing in the true existence of time and space, by believing in the myths of Urizen, as it were, who is trying to basically fool us. If we can see through that sham, then we can return to that kind of fourfold Eden.
So what you've explained is basics is basically Blake's terminology for gnosis.
I would say so. For Blake, the act of gnosis is twofold. It's based, first of all, on an intuition of the fact that every finite monad, properly seen, is a manifestation of some kind of infinite energy. You could call it spirit, you could call it eternity, you could call it Eden. But the minute that the visionary perceives this, for Blake anyway, he immediately wants to try to shape that vision into some kind of powerful work of art that reveals to the blinded masses, as it were, that there is another world out there beyond the merely physical, finite one that they think they're living in.
Blake was also very against, I don't know, the age of reason or just pure rationality, wasn't he?
Yes. He had a poem in which he castigated Voltaire and Rousseau, seeing them as manifestations of Enlightenment rationality, even though Rousseau doesn't quite fit in there. And Newton was his special enemy. He saw Newton in some ways as a great poet in and of himself who created this massive system, but the system in Blake's mind was overly mechanistic, overly rational, and therefore didn't grant humans any freedom, didn't grant humans any place for creativity. So Blake, in one of his poems, Jerusalem, says, I'm not here to reason and compare. I must create my own system or be enslaved by another man's. So I think in some ways Blake saw himself as creating a poetic system that would run counter to Newton's scientific system.
And what are some of the more basic or blatant Gnostic motifs that we find in his artwork?
Well, in his artwork...
What would you recommend for somebody to look at and through a Gnostic lens and go, whoa?
I think probably his most famous painting in this regard would be one called The Ancient of Days, which is really his painting of Urizen or Reason or the Demiurge. And basically you see this anthropomorphized godlike being with a big flowing beard kind of fiercely flashing out of his hands these spears of light. It's a rather fierce god. The other one would be his painting Newton, where we see Isaac Newton, rendered in Blake's art, sitting on what seems to be a seat of coral, possibly under some kind of ocean, this beautiful atmosphere surrounding him, but Newton's just staring straight down at the ground with his compass in his hand, suggesting that Newton or a god based on reason or a thinker based on reason is blind to the vast, infinite, beautiful wonders of the universe and is attentive only to what Blake calls ratio. And this is actually something worth talking about. Blake believed that most of us were duped by the Enlightenment. Most of us were duped into thinking that the only way to perceive the world correctly is to perceive what everybody else perceives. For Blake, this meant that most of us perceive a kind of lowest common denominator of perception. So if all of us, 10 of us, looked at the sun, as it were, and described what we saw, there would be a kind of collation of the common traits of what we saw, and that would be what the sun is. So individual vision is out. He called that ratio. As opposed to ratio, he talked about poetic vision, which is basically seeing the world as you see it, with your own particular genius and in its own particular way. And he gives a great example of this. He says, most people look at the sun and see a disk in the sky that looks like a little coin. They only see with the eye. I, on the other hand, look at the sun and see the host of angels singing, holy, holy, holy Lord on high. I see not with the eye, but through the eye, meaning that basically true vision is not to use the eye merely as a tool, but to see, as it were, through the eye, with the kind of visionary mind meeting with the world outside of itself.
What about, Eric, this red dragon that appears in some of his paintings? Who is he?
Can you tell me what you have in mind? Are you thinking about the end of the Book of Thel? For instance, he did have an interesting rendering in the Book of Thel of a young child riding on a dragon.
The one that always strikes me, well, obviously there's the one, I don't know if you've ever watched Red Dragon or read the book.
No.
It's done by the same guy who did the whole Silence of the Lambs thing. But one in which you have the lady and you've got this dragon floating over her. I always thought that was Sophia in the Demiurge.
Okay, well, it might well be. I don't think that painting doesn't really spring to mind. Blake certainly has a lot of female figures in his poetry that seem to share qualities with Sophia. It could well be what you suggest. It's a painting that I'm going to have to take a look at now for sure.
Yeah, definitely. Very striking. But moving on, Blake tacitly belonged to the Romantic poets. Probably most listeners don't know, but why were they called the Romantics since they weren't really romantic in our modern sense? You know what I mean?
Right, right. Well, I mean, it's very complex how that word romantic came to be applied to them. Actually, when Blake and Wordsworth and Coleridge and others were writing, they did not call themselves romantics at all. That term came from later commentators on the age. Of course, the word romance goes all the way. It's a French word that meant novel. And so in the Middle Ages, if you just thought of like a prose novel, often a prose novel was devoted to the Arthurian knights. That would have been called a roman. So some of the early commentators in the mid-19th century saw that many of the poets that we now call romantic sort of idealizing the Middle Ages, looking back to the Middle Ages as if they were some kind of, you know, rich, harmonious world that we'd fallen away from, a world imbued by God and spirit. We see this in people like Sir Walter Scott and Keats, for instance. So that's one reason the group got pinned as being romantic, right? But as you say, the way we use the word romantic is quite different from the way scholars use the word to talk about these poets. I guess the tie-in between our common word and what these poets were up to is feeling. Many of these poets of the Romantic Age rebelled against the Enlightenment, which tended to value reason, by valuing feeling, by valuing indeed personal feeling, by valuing uniqueness, individuality, and also valuing the possibility that one finds spirit not through following some kind of doctrine or dogma or church, but by looking within. And when one looks deeply enough within, one finds God within. And indeed, that's another way that Blake was Gnostic. He once said, all deities reside in the human breast, yet each of us is a god. And when we become artists, we become gods in our own right. And I think most of the Romantics on the British side and the American side shared that presupposition.
In your articles, you also mention the Gnostic themes in Shelley. What are some of the examples, Eric?
Well, I think Shelley's great Gnostic work would be Prometheus Unbound, in which he features the Prometheus of Greek myth, crucified on a rock in the Caucasus Mountains, where every day vultures come and eat out his guts. He heals at night, and the process starts over again. He is there because Zeus is punishing him. Prometheus, whose name means forethought, knows that one day one of Zeus's sons will grow up to overthrow him, just as Zeus overthrew his father. But Prometheus won't tell him this information, so Zeus has him crucified, as it were. So in this play, Prometheus on Brown, it's just a long play in verse. We see this clash between, again, the demiurge, Zeus, the tyrant god. And oftentimes Zeus in that play is compared to the Judeo-Christian god. And we can see Prometheus in this way as a kind of Gnostic savior, someone who is rebelling against the demiurges, going beyond the demiurges to steal fire and bringing that fire down to the people so they can live a richer life. The fire being, of course, a way of talking about the Gnostic spark. And furthermore, we can say in Shelley, there is this idea, too, that each of us, insofar as we are ruled by hatred, insofar as we are ruled by resentment, insofar as we are drunk on power, we ourselves become our kind of own demiurge. And only in renouncing hatred, resentment, and the desire for power can we free up our own sort of spirituality or our own Gnostic spark. So the great moment in that play, Prometheus Unbound, is when Prometheus says, I don't hate Zeus anymore. I know as long as I hate Zeus, I am Zeus. So when he stops hating Zeus, Zeus just goes away. And it's very much a play about the psyche, right? I mean, what happens between Prometheus and Zeus really takes place in all of us. So if we just kind of renounce that hatred, we open ourselves to the spirit and then the demiurge goes away, and indeed the trammels, the pollution of time and space go away at the same time. I should say too, we don't need to go into this, but in some ways, Shelley's wife, Mary Shelley, drew on some really interesting Gnostic motifs in her famous novel Frankenstein, right, where you see Victor Frankenstein as a kind of evil demiurge creating the monster as this inferior being caught in this horrendous body. And as the monster becomes increasingly human and opens up an increasingly spiritual sensibility, his creator, Victor, totally ignores him and treats him cruelly. So there's a little bit of action in Frankenstein as well in a Gnostic way.
Any other of the Romantic poets that lean towards the Gnostic worldview?
Well, I think we would have to go to America to get more some more serious Romantic Gnostics. Certainly people like Ralph Waldo Emerson were steeped in Jakobiama. They were steeped in Swedenborg. So we see some Gnostic leanings in Emerson, but Emerson is more a Neoplatonist, I would say, than a Gnostic at the end of the day. He was very optimistic about matter. I think the true Gnostic among the American Romantics would be Herman Melville. And we see his Gnosticism, or his knowledge of Gnosticism, I should say, really manifested in his greatest character, Captain Ahab in Moby Dick. Moby Dick shows Ahab in one of the more famous scenes, the quarterdeck speech, where he first announces to the crew that they're going to hunt for a white whale. At that time, Ahab says, all matter is but pasteboard mask, and pasteboard mask kind of pressed on me like the walls of a prison. And the true hero for Ahab strikes through the mask with his harpoon, and hopefully will find something behind the mask, the idea being that matter is a kind of prison, and that Moby Dick is a kind of embodiment of the kind of inherent evil of matter, and the idea being that if he can just kill Moby Dick, who is a kind of monster of chaos, a monster of matter, then he can get rid of all the evil in the world. Later in the novel, in a chapter called The Candles, he talks about how fire is a kind of masculine God principle, but beyond the fire, the masculine God principle is a female deity, a mother figure who is eternity to fire's time, who is infinity to fire's finitude. So it's interesting that Ahab himself seems to have a sense of a female deity, very much like Sophia, who would exist beyond matter. Now, Melville got his Gnosticism from the same sources that Blake did, probably, those sources I mentioned earlier.
And Moby Dick somehow represents the demiurge, doesn't he? Or,
well, to Ahab, he does, right? I think in some ways Moby Dick is a vast dialogue between Ahab, a Manichaean Gnostic, I would say. I mean, he really hates matter. He really, really thinks that matter is inherently evil. So he's a bit reductive and dualistic in his Gnosticism, I would say. And on the other hand, you have Ishmael, the narrator of the book, who has a more, I would say, optimistic take on matter and tends to be more Neoplatonic, the idea being that matter properly seen as a manifestation of spirit. So you see someone like Ishmael trying really hard to understand the mystery of Moby Dick, exploring Moby Dick, thinking about the whale as possibly as a manifestation of spirit itself. And yes, as you say, for Ahab, Moby Dick the whale is a kind of figure for the evil demiurge. So I wouldn't say that Melville was a Gnostic in the way that Blake had Gnostic leanings. I would say that Melville knew about Gnosticism, found it fascinating, and used it in a really powerful way in his novel Moby Dick.
And isn't the name of the ship, doesn't that give a clue? I forget the name of the ship and what it means.
Well, the Pequod refers to the Pequod Native American tribe who was wiped out in an 1637 war with the Puritans. Women, children were burned alive. It was really horrendous. And I think this is Melville's way of saying that Ahab and his quest are one with America's imperialistic notions of manifest destiny. And of course, with someone like Melville, this idea that America was somehow a superior nation that had the right to oppress others who got in the way of the great American experiment, he would have seen this as tyrannical and possibly as a manifestation of some kind of corrupt Christianity.
What happened later on when he wrote Billy Budd? Is that a traditional story about Jesus, or did he give some new wrinkles to it?
Well, I personally am not a huge fan of Billy Budd. Many people love it, and some even think it's better than Moby Dick. It does read beautifully. It's a very simple parable. It's an exploration of the problems of justice and authority. But in my feeling, ultimately, it reads almost like a Christian allegory in a way, where you see Billy Budd as a sort of innocence, who in his expression of innocence runs afoul of earthly authority, and is put to death for that, but becomes a sort of martyr for this Christ-like charity that he manifested. That's just my take on Billy Budd. Others might see more complexity there. Maybe I will. I'm teaching Billy Budd again for the first time in about 10 years. I'm looking forward to it. I'm, in fact, teaching a whole course on Melville right now, so we're going to go through almost all of it. and we're going to end with Billy Budd, so I have high hopes that I'll find more in Billy Budd this time around.
There you go. Okay, and moving on to your new book, like we mentioned, it is entitled Against Happiness, Considering American Obsession with Happiness, including the fact it's mentioned in the Declaration of Independence. Isn't the book's theme controversial, to say the least?
Well, I'm certainly one of the few people who has been publicly excoriated by Garrison Keillor.
Really?
Wow. Yeah, in the New York Times Sunday Book Review, he gave me a savagely negative review, which is kind of interesting. It's almost like getting slammed by Oprah. I say that just to highlight the fact that, yes, the book touched a nerve in many. Many felt that I was, of course, questioning the great American way. We in America expect to be happy. We in America have material comfort on the whole and think that that can make us happy. We in America seem to be addicted to happiness. A recent poll showed that 84% of Americans say they're happy, which seems shocking in our deeply tragic era. So many people were angered by the book just based on that alone, that I was questioning America's addiction to happiness and suggesting there was something wrong with waking up every morning and expecting only to be happy, something wrong with trying to avoid sadness. People also got angry thinking that I was somehow romanticizing depression, as if I were saying that we should go out and try to make ourselves depressed.
Right, you're in league with Tom Cruise or something.
certainly I'm not about that. I think the most profound influence on the book, actually, and is something of a Gnostic one. Like many of your listeners, and probably like yourself, my first introduction to Gnosticism was that great book by Hans Jonas, Religion. Uh-huh. And, of course, Jonas was a student of Heidegger, so his Gnosticism was really kind of inflected through early German existentialism. And what really spoke to me in that book was how longing, anxiety, exile, a sense of brokenness and fragmentariness are preludes to spiritual questing. The idea being that if you're not at home in the world, that if you feel out of place, if you feel discontented, it is precisely then that you start questioning the appearances around you and you start longing for something else, something possibly better. And you get what we might call that kind of spiritual gaze where you're trying to find something more than the world around you offers you. That was a really powerful motif, not only in my thinking about Gnosticism, but also in my thinking about the power of melancholy. Melancholy, of course, for centuries has been excoriated. For centuries, people have tried to avoid it. It was often seen as the worst possible state a person could be in, and certainly now it's often lumped with depression and often medicated in ways that perhaps it shouldn't be. But for me, melancholy was not a state to be avoided, but a very natural state that we all feel sometimes, a state that many of us feel most all the time. But in my reading, melancholy is exactly that perspective that encourages us to question the status quo, to look around at the conventions with which we've been brought up, to look at how things are and simply say, something's wrong here, I don't like this, I'm uneasy, I'm anxious. And when we feel that way, we often pull within. We often look within our interiors, trying to find new ways to relate to the world. So in this way, melancholy often leads to self-revelation. When we find these new powers within ourselves, we often want to act on them. We want to come up with new habits, new ways of seeing, new ways of being. So in this way, melancholy can also be creative. Now, again, I separate melancholy from depression. Depression is a state that is often not revelatory, and a state that is often not creative. But melancholy is, and I would say it's a kind of spiritual longing. So I guess that's the real Gnostic thrust of my book, aside from the fact that I have some pretty searing criticisms of what I see as kind of the demiurgic qualities of the Bush regime.
Right. Yeah. And it's not only that, but it seems not just political, but religious machines in our generations have turned themselves into happiness machines. It's not about spirituality. It's about God wants you to be happy. What happened? Is it because we became materialistic, or
I think in some ways this is just part of the American way, and it's been described from the very beginning of America as a colony. Even if we remember back in the 17th century, the first Puritans who came over, William Bradford's group, later John Winthrop's group, came over here to try to establish a kind of religious utopia, a perfect city of God that would be an example for all the world of perfect piety. Well, of course, that didn't happen, but the desire was there, the idea that America is a place where a kind of religious perfection can be achieved. Well, that got translated in the 18th century in the work of someone like Benjamin Franklin, the idea that America is not so much a place for religious utopia, but for economic utopia. If we work hard, we will make money and we will be happy. So this is the beginning of what later became known as the American dream, right? You can come over to America and you can find your kind of economic bliss, and that'll make you happy. So in those first two centuries of American history, we already see this kind of conflation of religion, prosperity, and happiness. And these all got really ramped up in the 19th century with this idea of manifest destiny, the idea that America is a blessed nation because it is democratic, because it is prosperous, because it is religious. And we have every right to spread this ideology wherever we want, killing people on the way, well, that's okay. So in this way, I would say happiness almost became a kind of commodity, something that could be sold or spread. So it's not surprising that in the middle of the 20th century, you see someone like Norman Vincent Peale come along with the power of positive thinking, basically treating Jesus as if he were a businessman, basically saying that if you simply go around quoting the right scriptures and thinking positively, you can make $1 million. So I think with that movement of Norman Vincent Peale, American Protestantism became increasingly, yes, a big happy club. Even to the, and I'm generalizing wildly here, I'm talking about tendencies, certainly there are many exceptions to what I'm saying, but you can see a prime example of this in the popular theologian Billy Graham, one of Norman Vincent Peale's big fans. Billy Graham, in one of his works, basically says that if you are sad, you are sinful. You are not, as it were, in sync with God. So if you're sad, you should simply pray a lot, and you'll be happy again, and that's your proper state. Now, in my mind, these theological trends are missing what seems to me a rather obvious fact. Whether you read Jesus Gnostically or not, Jesus was a deeply melancholy presence, a man of deep sorrow. We see this in the Garden of Gethsemane, the night before his crucifixion, where he's so distraught he sweats blood. He's a man clearly confused. I mean, is he man? Is he spirit? He's both at once. Had to be a very difficult position to be in. And then, of course, right at the moment he dies on the cross, he says, Father, Father, why hast thou forsaken me? And of course, the Beatitudes are very much about the power of mourning, the power of being poor in spirit. So it seems to me that one of the essential parts of the spiritual quest, Gnostic or otherwise, is this kind of melancholy longing for something else, this emptiness that hungers to be filled, the sense of dis-ease that craves a sort of power of vision that the familiar world just cannot give it.
And don't you mention that Carl Jung believed that melancholy and even neurosis could be an opportunity for spiritual growth, right?
Absolutely. I mean, Carl Jung, whom you well know was a deep student of Gnosticism and alchemy alike, had a sense that when we are neurotic, that is, when we are anxious, uneasy, nervous, we shouldn't flee from this state. We shouldn't try to escape it, repress it, ignore it, marginalize it, medicate it. In fact, we should sit with it and learn from it. It is a signal sent to us from the unconscious. And of course, Jung actually likened the unconscious in some cases to the pleroma, interestingly. It's almost like a message from the spiritual realm telling us we need to change our lives. We need to reorient ourselves. If we're anxious, we're out of whack. We go all the way back to Blake here. It's like we're emphasizing one part of ourselves at the expense of others. We're being too rational and not emotional enough, or the other way around. So this neurosis, this anxiety, this melancholy is really telling us what we need to do. If we sit with it, if we're patient with it, we'll learn something and we'll reorient our lives to the unconscious and ultimately we'll have a healthier life. So certainly for Jung, melancholy, it's not something to be cultivated. It's something that occurs naturally. And when it does occur, we should be glad. It's almost like a gift, a message, a healing dose.
Yeah, and Jung himself, it's not like he was just talking out of his, you know, out of his ass. He went through years of heavy melancholy, didn't he?
Oh, profound melancholy. And really, in the entire decade of the 19-teens, Jung was in horrific turmoil. I mean, during this period, he had a break with Freud. He realized that he and Freud disagreed ultimately about the nature of the unconscious. Freud thought it was basically a kind of reservoir of sexual energy. Jung ultimately thought that it led to these archetypes. There was a big break. Jung felt horrible about that. His mother died around this time, and also this was the time when World War I broke out. So Jung fell into a period of deep psychic suffering. I mean, he had these horrific visions and daydreams of the world being overrun by this kind of sickly yellow sea flooding over all the great cities of Europe. And it was during this time that he actually got interested in Gnosticism, mainly the work of Basilides. And as some of his early notebooks show, he actually had visions of Gnostic figures and saw them as mentors. And it was this time we started using the language of Gnosticism to talk about the unconscious, pleroma being a potential word for the unconscious, and self being a kind of manifestation of the pleroma. So to get back to your initial point, certainly Jung suffered deeply, but he learned from that suffering. He didn't flee from it. He realized that out of his suffering would grow something greater than was there before the suffering. And this is a time to Jung's alchemy, right? The alchemist, as Jung reads him, is not someone who's simply trying to turn lead into gold. He's someone who's interested in how when something is dissolved down into its primal components, it can be rebuilt into something stronger than before. So many alchemists would, of course, boil down metals into their primal constituents, return them to their primal chaos, their prima materia, and then add certain tinctures and chemicals to reform this kind of boiling mass into a substance stronger and more beautiful than it was before. For Jung, this is ultimately what melancholy can do. It breaks us down. It dismembers us. It kind of dissolves us. And if we sit with the melancholy, if we're patient, we can resolve ourselves into stronger, more capacious, insightful human beings.
Yeah, I love how you mentioned how who was Bruce Springsteen during a bout of melancholy released Nebraska, which I find to be his best album up to this day.
Oh, so. Me too. Very powerful, very powerful. And it precisely grew out of a period of deep melancholy for him. And you know, Bruce, off and on throughout his life, has fallen into pretty serious bouts of melancholy and has sought psychotherapy for it. But he's certainly not an artist who has run from that. I mean, many of his greatest songs are informed by a deep sense of longing and loneliness, and certainly many of those songs in Nebraska, leading off with that high, lonesome harmonica sound, kind of wails into the void, are just very powerful examples of how sorrow, suffering can often be turned into really powerful insights in art.
Could you name some of the great figures of history that were epitomized melancholy or perhaps were gripped through melancholy all throughout their lives?
Well, sure, and I think in some of these figures I might cite may have actually struggled with depression too. I mean, it's a really hard question, the difference between melancholy and depression, and certainly someone like Van Gogh or Virginia Woolf, even though that sorrow informed much of their work, they probably were clinically depressed, and of course both committed suicide. But I think we can look at someone like John Keats, someone like Samuel Taylor Coleridge, Melville himself, even Blake. We can look at Emily Dickinson. Abraham Lincoln was a very melancholy person.
Very true.
And we can look at musicians. We can look at someone like Beethoven, Handel, rather melancholy souls, Mahler as well. The list is long. More recent figures, someone like Joni Mitchell, struggled through lots of depression, especially in the 60s and 70s. Even actors, surprisingly enough, someone like Cary Grant was deeply melancholy. Someone like Jim Carrey. A lot of our comedians, Lenny Bruce, quite melancholy. So, and that's actually something I wish I would have explored more, the time between comedy, kind of dark comedy and melancholy would be really interesting to think about. But the list is long of people who simply use their melancholy as a kind of muse. And again, I don't want to give the impression that melancholy, as I'm defining it, leads to this sort of antisocial brooding that we often associate with melancholy. I'm not some grown-up emo or goth or grunger. some people have accused me of that. But I'm thinking in particular of a great example of what melancholy can do in the life and work of John Keats. Not quite a contemporary of Blake. They overlapped a little bit. They didn't know each other. Blake labored in obscurity for the most part. Keats lived a rather difficult, sorrowful life. He was an orphan at a young age. A beloved brother died when he was young. Keats himself was apprenticed to a surgeon, spent a lot of time in hospitals around London watching people suffer in the age before anesthesia. He himself, when he was barely 20 years old, knew that he had tuberculosis and that he would die soon. But he didn't let this sorrow crush him or lead him to run into some kind of shallow escape like opium or Christianity. Instead, he realized that it was his suffering who made him who he was and ultimately opened him up to the world's beauty. And this to me is a major moment in thinking about melancholy. And indeed, it's the favorite part of my book when I talk about this. Keats believed that we can only experience the world's beauty when we know that the world is dying. It's ephemeral, it's transient, it's decaying. So when we look at, say, a real rose as opposed to a porcelain rose, that real rose is beautiful because it is fragile, it's tender, it could blow over at any moment or be stepped on at any moment. That's precisely what makes it beautiful, because we know how precious it is because it's not going to be there long. So for Keats, there's this really interesting relationship among sorrow. I'm sad because this rose is dying. I'm exuberant because I experienced this rose's beauty. And what do I want to do? I want to create beauty myself. And Keats and Kali really brings this to life.
That's about all the time we have today. I think we've run the gamut, and I'd like to thank you for coming on the show.
Well, thanks, Miguel. I had a great time. It's always a pleasure to talk to you and to think about Gnosticism, a series of ideas that have just continued to occupy me. I'm always really glad to talk about those ideas. So thank you.
Oh, no, thank you. And good luck with your book and good luck with your Herman Melville class. Maybe you can come back if you find any more revelations on Billy Budd.
I sure will. Thanks so much.
All right. Have a good day now.
Okay. You too. Bye. Bye.
And there you have it, my beloved truth seekers. William Blake and other sundries with our interview with Eric Wilson, professor of English at Wake Forest University and author of Against Happiness and Praise of Melancholy, Secret Cinema, Gnostic Vision and Film, The Spiritual History of Ice, Romanticism, Science and Imagination, and several other arousing books. A wonderful man and a wonderful guest always.
We find many viewers leave him on all night for comfort.
For more information on Eric, please visit his homepage, wfu.edu/WilsonEG, or just Google his name and Wake Forest. Like I said, he's got some real horror show articles. I'm certainly envious of anyone who has participated in his lectures. Hopefully many of his students have been gripped by the Gnostic Dharma, as Eric expresses its worldview through the lenses of movies and the great romantic poets and beyond.
How do you fight an idea, especially a new idea?
Like I've said before, I've quoted Blake aplenty on Aeon Byte. But small quotes don't do him justice unless you fully read such works as The Marriage of Heaven and Hell or The Book of Urizen. But to further illustrate the ectoplasmic genius of William Blake, let me go ahead and quote some of his words to make sure you soberly consider the importance of this timeless Gnostic saint.
Were you going to plagiarize the whole thing for us? Do you have any thoughts of your own on this matter? Or is that your thing? You come into a bar, you read some obscure passage, and then pretend you pawn it off as your own idea just to impress some girls, embarrass my friend?
Thinking as I do that the creator of this world is a very cruel being, and being a worshipper of Christ, I cannot help saying, the Son, oh how unlike the Father. First God Almighty comes with a thump on the head, then Jesus Christ comes with a balm to heal it. Or how about this one? To see the world in a grain of sand, and to see heaven in a wild flower, whole infinity in the palm of your hands, and eternity in an hour. And this one, If the doors of perception were cleansed, everything would appear to man as it is, infinite. For man has closed himself up, till he sees all things through chinks of his cavern. And this one, my beloved true seekers. Unorganized innocence, an impossibility. Innocent dwells with wisdom, but never with ignorance. And here is a quote from the Book of Urizen, which you'll find reeks of the Demiurge's creation of the world and the warnings of St. Paul. 6 days they shrunk up from existence, and on the seventh day they rested, and they blessed the seventh day in sick hope, and forgot their eternal life. And their 30 cities divided in form of a human heart, no more could they rise at will, in the infinite void, but bound down to earth by their narrowing perceptions. They lived a period of years, then left a noisome body to the jaws of devouring darkness. And their children wept and built tombs in the desolate places, and formed laws of prudence, and called them the eternal laws of God. And lastly, from the everlasting gospel, the vision of Christ that thou dost see is my vision greatest enemy. Thine has a great hook nose like thine, mine has a snub nose like to mine. Thine is the friend of all mankind, mine speaks in parables to the blind. Thine loves the same world that mine hates, thy heaven doors are my hell's gates. Socrates taught what Meletus loathed as a nation bitterest curse, and Caiaphas was in his own mind a benefactor of mankind. Both read the Bible day and night, but thou readest black where I read white.
I think he's right. There's something about this that's so black. It's like, how much more black could this be? And the answer is none.
You can't get more Gnostic than this, my beloved true seekers, without shoving your head up the arse of Valentinus. Like Stephen Haller wrote, every serious artist is already half a Gnostic. Some of these artists complete the circle together and become living containers of the divine imagination. In other words, to you artists, William Blake's legacy is a call to arms to embrace your inner God-man and forever change the stream of consciousness of the human mind for all eternity. I am, and I am Abraxas, broadcasting at the virtual Alexandria through the GodAboveGod.com. The road is ended, the song is over. Thought I'd have something more to say. But don't cultivate any troubles, my beloved true seekers. Because like heaven above you, the spies that love you, I'm keeping all of your secrets safe with me tonight. Hello and goodbye as always.
I started a joke, which started the whole world crying. But I